present yet again this year and trying to think of something different to say. So I have picked something different. I'll take responsibility for that. Just take us a little bit back from some of the clinical outcome focus we've had so far. But if you're wondering why this talk is this particular session, you'll have to ask me because it's a little bit of a turn. I think it is appropriate to start rethinking our approach to cardiovascular disease risk in women. And so I thought this talk might be an opportunity to open that door and again step more back into some pathophysiology. And it will involve both reviewing where we are with regards to menopausal hormonal effects, or at least the effects of menopause on heart disease risk, where lipoproteins fit in. And I'll also be able to present some new data, which I developed in part in response to the opportunity to present here today. These are my disclosures. So let me give you some background. This will be in a couple of different sections. The first will be clinical background regarding the relationship of menopause to cardiovascular disease risk in women. I think everybody here is aware that premenopausal women are protected from CVD versus men of the same age. And the risk is generally similar to that of men who are 10 years younger. Protection is lost in most menopausal years. And then women catch up, and notably, the risk then becomes higher than by about age 80. I'll come back to that point later in the talk. Now, this increase in CVD risk has been attributed in part to increased LDL cholesterol. Now, there's obviously many, many other factors involved. This talk is going to focus on the LDL connection. It is relevant, as I'll try to explain, in ways that perhaps and then finally, since estradiol can lower LDL cholesterol, that's well established, the loss of CVD protection postmenopause has been attributed in part to reduced estrogen effect. So this is all information we pull from the literature. It's something I've followed off and on for quite a while. And we're still trying to put the pieces together, but these are some of the key elements. There are some less well-resolved issues. First, to what extent does increased LDL cholesterol explain the increase in CVD risk in postmenopause? Second, and this is an important one, obviously, from a clinical perspective, is there evidence that estrogen effects can reverse atherogenic lipid changes and hence CVD risk outcomes in postmenopause? And then finally, a more subtle point, if this is true, is there an optimum time window for such a benefit to become manifest? And then, of course, what are the competing risks? So all of these are large topics, not fully resolved. And I won't attempt today to cover all of them. I'm going to focus really on these first two points. I'll touch a little bit on the third a little bit later in the talk. So again, stepping into this field and giving you the background for what I'm about to tell you, I'm going to take the liberty of reviewing for you what we mean by LDL cholesterol. That's one of the things that I've brought before this conference repeatedly over many years, and I'll tell you right now, I'm going to have to do it again. Some of you may not have attended before, and I'm going to review some of the basics of LDL biology so that we can come back to see how this fits into the story of menopause and hormone replacement. I'm sure most of you have now, we've seen this slide, but we probably recited by heart because I've shown it so many times. But this is to paint the spectrum of the major LDL species, ranging from the larger cholesterol, larger the larger cholesterol-rich particles, denser LDL or cholesterol related. And to put the structure of LDL into a more physiologic perspective, I will again review for you some of the concepts that have evolved from work done by many of us over the years that have helped to understand the pathways. This is something that there's pathways involving cholesterol and triglyceride. Here we're going to take a deeper dive into the pathways affecting LDL particles, beginning with TG secretion in the liver, through a canonical pathway involving mid-sized VLDL particles, TG-enriched particles, that yield medium-sized LDL that are rapidly cleared by LDL receptors. This is the major normal pathway. There's a subsidiary pathway which can operate when there's cholesterol depletion, triglyceride depletion in the liver, when this TG pools are low, cholesterol is the major transport lipid, and you produce smaller VLDL particles that are less triglyceride-enriched, and they yield larger LDL. Then finally, the pathway we're most interested in this meeting, which we've been hearing about repeatedly, not just this year, but almost every year that I can remember, is the pathway characterized by a higher TG content in the liver, producing the particles that are larger TG-rich VLDL that are secreted and progressively transformed through lipase into remnant particles, and ultimately nibbled down through a series of events that involve both lipolysis as well as exchange. The remnants can be returned to the liver, but the remnants can also serve as a substrate for CETP, which can cause the exchange of cholesterol and triglyceride between remnants and both small LDL and HDL, yielding even smaller particles. Note that those smaller particles have much less affinity for the LDL receptor, resulting in increased plasma residence time. Now, I'm going to focus a lot on this pathway for obvious reasons, but I want you to pay attention particularly to this middle round here, because when you measure triglyceride in plasma, when you measure even VLDL, you are never measuring truly nascent particles. By the time they appear in plasma, they are already partially lipolysed, and they really form remnants that are spectral, going from larger to smaller remnants. And so it's the remnant pathway that I think we need to pay more attention to, and I'll try to justify that as we go on. This is the phenotype that has been called atherogenic dyslipidemia, characteristic of metabolic syndrome. So it's higher triglyceride, lower HDL, but it's also this whole spectrum of particles. So that's really the physiological background, and again, I'm not going to dwell on the pathologic aspects other than particularly in view of Christie's preceding me on the program, allude to a slide as a result of a paper that he published from Eric several years ago that I also like to show because it really strongly illustrates the specificity of cardiovascular disease risk for smaller particles in that if you divide the LDL into small dense LDL cholesterol versus large buoyant, which is itself a bit of an oversimplification, but it really identifies a gradient of risk on the left ranging from the lowest to the highest quartiles of small dense LDL cholesterol that is not seen at all with large buoyant. It's really quite flat. So this illustrates the importance of the smaller particles that are part of this atherogenic dyslipidemia as being, there's certainly biomarkers, but there's a number of reasons to suspect that they are causally related to cardiovascular risk in this syndrome. What is the basis for this? Well, this reduced receptor binding, I think, is one of the key points. Particles that are circulating longer in plasma cholesterol-rich particles have potential for becoming modified in many ways, oxidation, other types of degradation products that can accumulate at the surface, and ultimately these particles can wind up in the artery wall. The smaller LDL also have the tendency for greater arterial proteoglycan binding. They're more susceptible to the larger LDL, and then they are part of this whole syndrome. So this is their role as a biomarker as well as a potential causative factor in the syndrome. And then there are atherogenic components, probably multiple components, that accumulate these particles, including oxidized lipids and ApoC3. I've highlighted ApoC3. This actually comes all the way back to some discussion we had off and on during this meeting, beginning with Jorge Plutsky's talk at the opening session. on the importance of APOC3. So let me take a minute or two to tell you why this is an important protein for cardiovascular disease. As you, I'm sure many of you know, it's a small exchangeable apolipoprotein protein that is found in all lipoprotein classes, but particularly when it's associated with ApoB-containing particles, it's directly associated with cardiovascular risk. It can reduce receptor-mediated clearance of triglyceride-rich and remnant lipoprotein particles. And this, again, is the theme of increasing the residence time in plasma. The C3 can directly promote arteriopropion-glycan binding of LDL. I showed this a number of years ago with Alan Shea. And it has been shown by Peter LeMay and Frank Sachs and Alvin to have direct pro-inflammatory properties. Frank Sachs' group also showed, as shown in this slide by the Phil Diamonds, that if you separate LDL into the particles containing APOC3 in black versus those lacking C3 in the open squares, it's the C3 containing LDL that are associated more strongly with risk. So it pinpoints the atherogenicity of these particles to an even greater extent than this LDL size. So I'm now going to move to some of the insights that have been gained by further analysis of LDL particle heterogeneity using the technique of ion mobility. I won't have time to describe all the features of this technique. It involves an electrospray that directly spreads out the lipoprotein spectrum according to particle size from HDL up through VLDL. We can measure particle concentrations at very fine intervals across this region with high reliability and sensitivity. When you apply this technique, and this is an illustration that itself has not been published, I bring it up because we've been aware of this observation for many years and have not yet found a suitable occasion to publish it. I think it's an important one. As most people think about LDL cholesterol as a marker for LDL particles, but I just told you that there are remnants, that there are smaller VLDL particles, and intermediate density lipoproteins are IDL that are also part of the ApoB-containing lipoprotein spectrum. And if you measure LDL cholesterol, as is shown here, in 715 men and women, just a standard assay, and this, no matter which formula you use, certainly the standard would be the Friedewald formula. Take that measurement as commonly applied in the clinic, and to see whether that is correlated with across the part of the spectrum of VLDL, IDL, and LDL, what's quite striking is that the strongest correlations are not with the two LDL particles, but with the IDL and smaller VLDL in that plasma specimen. So LDL cholesterol is not what most people think it is. It is a composite. It's a biomarker, as Christy mentioned in this case, of a spectrum of particles in two distributions, both the true LDL as well as a spectrum of particles which represent the tail end of the remnant lipoprotein distribution. So this begins to bring in the remnant particles in a way that really overlaps with the way we perceive LDL cholesterol, and it impacts every clinical decision we make, at least from the standpoint of pathophysiology, impacts how we interpret clinical trials. By not distinguishing these two components of LDL, the standard LDL cholesterol, the measurement, we may be missing something very important. I'm trying to convince you that remnant particles are important. In fact, when we did stepwise regression using LDL cholesterol as a dependent variable, 48% of variance was accounted for by IDL. So remnants are a strong determinant of plasma LDL. So if you take anything away from this lecture in terms of your background understanding of your laboratory measurements, try to remember this one. So why are remnant lipoproteins important? They are very strongly associated with coronary risk. This is a slide which shows three different categories of lipoproteins: remnant cholesterol, HDL cholesterol, and LDL cholesterol. And two different kinds of evidence relating those measurements to cardiovascular outcomes. One is observational data in the first line of each, and the second uses Mendelian randomization technique in which genetic variance associated with this measurement can be related to the association of those variants with disease outcomes and help establish at least infer causality. So we see right at the top that observational data have associated amendments with cardiovascular outcomes. The genetic data, even more strongly so. HDL cholesterol illustrates the case that I think you're probably all familiar with, where observational data suggests an important role for reduced HDL and increasing risk, whereas the causal connection for HDL has not been established. For LDL cholesterol, the observational data and the causal genetic data work pretty well. We've also found that remnant particles are associated with residual risk in the Jupiter trial in patients on maximum statin therapy. So this is an important, again, indication that these remnant particles can be predictors of residual risk. Remnant particles do occur in the LDL distribution, and they are enriched in APOC3. So remember, I talked about C3 enrichment of LDL being associated with risk. Well, the C3 is also enriched in these remnants, and in this sort of brackets the LDL distribution with two classes of particles that are both atherogenic. So we have now a refinement of this atherogenic dyslipidemia pathway in which we've regulated the particles C3 all the way down to small LDL. And the C3 is responsible for reducing remnant clearance, reducing small LDL clearance, increasing binding of these particles to the RV wall. And this one really, I think, puts the remnant particles as really maybe the ugly form of lipoproteins we talked about, good, bad, and ugly. This I think, really does operate at the center of atherogenesis in the kind of patients we're talking about here in this meeting. Can we benefit risk by lowering remnants? We saw this slide that Paul showed in more repeated detail, subgroups of individuals, in this case from the ACCORD trial, who are most likely to have increased remnant particles are going to show the greatest benefit from the fibrate that can lower the TG levels. Jorge talked a little bit about the APOC3 genetic data. This is, if you didn't hear his talk, I'll just briefly summarize what's shown here is genetic data indicating variants that lower APOC3 would be predicted to lower cardiovascular risk by a certain amount shown here. The observed risk is actually quite similar, so these genetic variants can be associated with a 40% reduction in cardiovascular disease risk related to APOC3 concentration. We do have opportunities for lowering C3. We heard a little bit about those in earlier talks. So I'm going to move now toward the end with the new data, which is really the major topic of the title of my talk, and what happens in postmenopause. And so we use data that was derived from cross-sectional studies in a rather modest population, a well-studied population from our program spanning the ages of 30 to 90. I'm not sure you can see the colors on this slide as well as I do, but if you look at the results across the age spectrum, like in men, you'll see there is an increase in LDL cholesterol with age that tails off a little bit in later life. That may be a survival effect. In women, however, we start off with lower LDL in younger ages. There is a crossover that occurs at about the time of menopause, and that's a sex by age interaction. So there is a clear separation in the relationship of age to LDL cholesterol in men versus women, crossing at about the time of menopause. When you break that down in terms of lipoprotein particles, it's the remnant lipoproteins that account completely for that relationship. So remember I told you that LDL cholesterol, as we measure it, is a composite of both 2LDL and remnant particles, these remnants or IDLs, increase with age, and again, cross over with men at about the time of menopause with a significant sex by age interaction. And we found similar results for small VLDL, but not for other lipoprotein fractions or lipids. So this is really very much focused on a remnant particle pathway. And then finally, we have APOC3 levels in this population showing exactly the same relationships, which tend to cluster these observations regarding remnants and our LDL measurements around a possible possible pathophysiological mechanism involving APOC3. But in view of the time, I won't be able to talk about the HDL particle changes. Let me just say briefly from the slide that those changes are rather modest, certainly in comparison to the OPL change. And there's really no evidence of these changes with age impact CVD risk. Now, the finding of hormonal effects, again, we have very limited data. This is a small study, it's cross-sectional, so presented with just a caution. But one looks at hormone users versus non-hormone users in the population that I just described for you, one sees the predicted differences in LDL cholesterol being lower in users of hormones. This is a combination of estrogen and progestin, triglycerides being higher, HDL cholesterol also being somewhat higher. That's a characteristic profile. And when we break it down to lipoprotein particles, if the hormone users have increased levels shown in red of the small and very small LDL particles, that's a borderline significant increase, but with a small number, it certainly bears concern. It has been reported by others as well, and I won't have time to talk about the HDL changes. So to summarize, what I tried to describe for you is the importance of the pathway giving rise to remnant lipoproteins at the center of the atherogenic nexus that I think is very important causally for all of us, but certainly in the case of postmenopause, where this increased surge appears to occur at around the time of menopause, this can contribute to increased risk. It's not reversed by hormones. The hormones, if anything, appear to push particles farther down the small LDL pathway. So in conclusion, what I told you is that greater age-related increase in LDL cholesterol in women versus men, mainly due to atherogenic remnant lipoprotein particles. Now, these data still are preliminary. It's a conclusion based on evolving data, and we replicated it internally with another population I should mention in our own program. But we're now looking to see if we can take this to larger populations to strengthen this even further. Postmenopausal years, these remnant lipoproteins exceed levels found in men, so that may be part of the reason we have this excess cardiovascular disease mortality in older women. And they likely contribute to increased CVD risk in this population. Hormone therapy can reduce the LDL cholesterol, but it doesn't really reverse the risk. Smaller HDL particles are increased by hormones, but this does not reverse age-related changes. I'm going to skip this slide for time and take us to the next conclusion. Age-related changes in APOC3 in women versus men beginning in the premenopausal years. Again, this begins early. It doesn't happen at menopause. There's an age-related change contribute to increased levels of these atherogenic remnants. And this is not reversed by hormone treatment. I didn't show you those data. So therapies aimed at reducing APOC3 levels may have particular benefit for reducing CVD risk in postmenopausal women. That's something that we may be able to test ultimately as we get patients available that can lower remnant lipoproteins. So the clinical implications right now are limited, other than to say that monitoring LDL cholesterol, and if desirable, you might want to look at remnant lipoprotein particles, can identify premenopausal women who are at higher risk for CVD. Reduction in levels of these particles can require therapies that are not hormones, but other therapies that can lower both LDL and triglyceride levels. And here, we really need to focus as much as we can on lifestyle, because we know that works. So I want to acknowledge the sponsor of this research, and thanks for your attention.